Рабство Достена. So I will talk about Prabhupada post and it talk about 20 years for us to understand that the Kaplan post comes from the Karl Anomaly and to realize that the Karl Anomaly it was necessary to consider Helium 3A, which is what I started. And I also thought that I would make a short talk because Володя yourself, you have more things to say, so why not talk a little shorter?
Okay.
I hope. Helium 3 contains white points, two points in momentum space. Both of these points the system behaves as a relativistic fermions, and that's why there are Karl anomaly and all that. And Kolev, he already calculated his Kaplan force for the case of Helium 3A, and found that in this case his force has a maximum value. And this maximum value just corresponds to the value which can be obtained using the phenomenon of Karl anomaly and spectral flow. Okay, but for that we must return back to the two major universality classes. One of these classes is a class of Fermilik, and another is a class of Fermi points or Wien points. Where the vacuum of dark model is its kind of fermions also belongs to, and superfluid Helium 3A where Kolev calculated his Kaplan force. So in this case there are points in momentum space where which hold the Hitchcock. The typical example is Hamiltonian, which is sigma dot p. It is, this Hamiltonian describes the right-handed fermions because P is a good quantization axis for spin, and spin must be oriented along momentum if the energy is positive. That's why in momentum space all the spins for each state spin is along the momentum of this forms the Hitchcock, which is very similar to the Hitchcock to the monopole, magnetic monopole. Real space, but here the situation is different because this is a topological defect, but this is just a uniform, completely homogeneous vacuum, but in the momentum space there is a singularity. Singularity is here where the spin is not determined, and that's why the energy goes to zero. So when P equals to zero, the Hamiltonian goes to zero. And it appears that this topological charge exists not only for relativistic system, but also for the non-relativistic system like Helium 3A. In Helium 3A, the gap has two nodes, and close to these two nodes, the topological charge, there is a Hitchcock of this type near this point, and the same is near that point. The only difference is the Hitchcock near this direction is has positive topological charge, which means that the spirals, the spins, they are outward. But for this guy, the quasi-particles usually here, they have the Hitchcock in the opposite direction, so it's spines inward, which means that spin is opposite to momentum, and that's why it is left-handed particle. So here is the right-handed particle, here is left-handed particle, here is the topological charge. Right-handed particle. And there is the general Atiyah Shapiro construction for mathematicians who are not present here, that close to the Fermi point, if the Fermi point has some momentum, then one obtains tetrads and effective Gauss field. And this effective Gauss field is given by the position of the weak point. The weak point occurs either PFA, so here the vector potential is PFA, or minus PFL, but this also corresponds to the potential, vector potential PFL, but the electric charge is chosen to be minus 1. So we have effectively positive left-handed electron living here, and negative right-handed electron living, positrons living there. If L, the position of the node, its texture, in texture L can be oriented in different directions, that's why one we have a texture corresponds to the curl of L, which gives effective magnetic field. But if we make the time dependence of L, which happens in the Boolean vortex, then we have also L dot, which corresponds to the effective electric field. So we can create both electric and magnetic field by moving the vortex, and this vortex is a so-called skirbion, which this is a doubly quantized vortex, which doesn't have any singularity, it's completely continuous, and L vector here is depicted, so you can see that the texture exists, so we have curl L, which corresponds to the effective magnetic field, but if the vortex is moving, then L depends on time, L depends on time, and that's why we have L dot, which corresponds to the effective electric field. And for electric and magnetic field, it's known that there is, in case of the current fermions, it knows that there is the phenomenon of Carroll anomaly. So what does it mean? If you say apply magnetic field, then in addition to the Landau levels, there will be the branch, the function of momentum Pz, which crosses zero. So for the Carroll fermions, we have such quantization. There is a branch, which is a function of momentum along the magnetic field. This is energy as a function of Pz. There is a branch which crosses zero, and that's why when we these states are occupied, these are empty, and when we now apply the electric field in addition, which is parallel to magnetic field, then they start to move along this branch and go from the negative energy level to the positive, and that's why there is a creation of some charge. And this creation of some charge can be described by Adler and Bell and Jakiv, and this is actually the Carroll anomaly. So the creation of charge comes the one, it's not the creation of pair, it's the creation of charge one by one. And it can be described, so this is a hypermagnetic field, which is one of the fields of some dark model, and if in early universe there was hypermagnetic field and hyperelectric field, then B dot E produces.
What is B dot?
Sorry?
What is B dot?
B dot is baryonic charge. The baryonic charge is produced, and this factor has quantized value, this prefactor, and this quantized value depends on the topological invariant expressed in terms of the Green's function. And inside the trace, there is a baryonic charge, and there is two hypercharges. And this corresponds to the triangle final diagram, which describes the Carroll anomaly, where here is a B charge interaction with effective baryonic H field, which is effective and this hypermagnetic field. So if we take this trace, we find that the baryonic charge production per unit time per unit volume is proportional to the sum of all the fermions, fermions A. B, A is the baryonic charge of the fermion, C, A is the chirality, and Y, A is the hyperchargeable of this. It can be minus 1c, plus 1/3, or whatever. Okay, so the same situation actually occurs for helium 3k, but now instead of the production of the baryons, what happens is that when the particle crosses, when the particle energy crosses zero, then each particle carries the momentum BFL if its chirality is negative, or minus BFL if its chirality is positive. That's why one has so this is actually similar expression for the creation of the linear momentum. Now instead of the baryonic charge, there is a, this is linear momentum which is carried by particle when the crossing occurs. CA is chirality and momentum different chiralities plus and minus one have different opposite momentum, that's why this is not zero. And electric charge is simply effective and space simply plus and minus one. And
V Полис считал зависимость от температуры своей силы. А ты вроде нам говоришь просто, что она существует или не существует?
Нет. No, in three phase it doesn't depend on temperature. And this is determined only by this equation. Okay, I'm going to tell about the helium 3b, where it will be the dependence on temperature. But now, so he got this result, it was not clear what is the reason, but just the now, okay. And now you can apply this to the skirmion, because you know what is B, what is E. And one after is the production of the momentum. Production of the momentum per unit time is just the force acting on the motors. Okay, so we apply this equation where this is the momentum carried by each of these chiral fermions. B we know it is scaled L, E we know it's F dot times by Pf. And then after integration over the skirmions, we find that this is some quantity Pf cubed divided by 3p squared, which is almost the particle density, because it's recoupling approximation. Recoupling approximation density of the particle is Pf cubed divided by 3p squared, even in superconducting state. Times z is direction along the vortex, and this is Vn minus Vm. Vn is the velocity of the normal heat cap mass, normal component, and Vl is the velocity of the vortex line. So this is just coming force with a prefactor which is just the density. So,
excuse me, from where has the normal force appeared, normal velocity appeared? In previous lines there is no...
Yes, but when it starts to move, then from here, then there is a collision with the normal component quasi particles which live above.
From time derivative of frame?
Yes, time derivative of frame, it should be in the frame with respect to the normal component velocity. Okay, so in such a way this force has been observed, and actually the experiment has been done, and that, there is no temperature dependence of this quantity, and this quantity was equal just the total density of the liquid. So it completely compensated the Magnus force. So we see if you take Vs equal to Vn, for example, no counter flow, then these two forces are completely cancel each other. And this was just experimental result. So with accuracy of 1% or 2%, there was complete cancellation in the experiment. So this was confirmation of his calculations and also the spectral flow force. Okay, now let's go to singular vortex. If you consider the singular For the single water situation completely different. But let's first consider the case when the core radius is much larger than the coherent length. So in principle, the vortices are singular, but real numerical simulation shows that the core size is really big. It's about 5 coherent lengths. So let's suppose that the core radius is larger than the coherent length, then we can apply the semi-classical approximation. And in this semi-classical approximation, one can find that what happens inside the vortex core is that there are two, there are at some radius two nodes MPN, this is so-called planar phase, and this node splits in two with two different spins, so there are four different wild points. And each wild point gives rise, it's also in tension and it's moving tension. And each wild point gives its own contribution to the Carroll anomaly. As a result, you can integrate and obtain exactly the same result as for as for obtained as for Helium 3A. But this is an approximation of large core. And large core corresponds to the case when to the following case when actually the Excel anomaly equation can be can be valid. Okay, so what happens in a real situation? Which was also calculated by Coyle, but earlier, because he calculated for singular vortices before he calculated for the continuous vortices. In the spectrum of, say, Carolina-Jenner matrical spectrum in the S-wave superconductors, it depends on linear momentum, on linear momentum and on linear momentum is E and on Q, Q is angular momentum. So in terms of the angular momentum, it is angular momentum is quantized and it is n plus 1/2, and there is a branch which crosses zero, but it's not continuous branch, it's branch of discrete levels. So the distance between them is called mini gap. This mini gap is much smaller than the gap in conventional situation, it's 3 orders of millimeters smaller. And everything depends on the is this mini gap smaller than in width of the level or larger than the width of the level? If the distance is between the levels is smaller than the width of the level, then you practically have continuous spectrum, and that's why one can have the same spectrum flow but along momentum. Mm-hmm. And if you calculate the spectrum flow along momentum, you calculate what is the momentum production, you exactly obtain the coupling force with the full which corresponds just to Carroll anomaly. So the parameter C is a function of T is exactly equal to the density of state. But this is for the case
when... Mass density.
Sorry?
To mass density.
To mass density, sorry. To mass density, yes. To mass density, yes. And this corresponds to the case when omega not 2 much smaller than unity. This is actually the result of the coupling calculation in this ring. But here calculated, of course, everything. And when omega not 2 is of order of unity or larger, then the spectrum flow is suppressed because you see it's necessary to jump. It's not just the continuous motion, but it's necessary to jump from level to pull through the zero energy. And that's why the spectrum flow is suppressed, and in this limit it's suppressed completely, and the complete force exactly disappears. And this is also experimentally found. Yes, this is just an experiment how it depends on temperature. Omega not tau depends on temperature, and this is a region where omega not tau much smaller than unity, and there is a complete compensation of the Markov force. But in this limit of low temperature, when collision time becomes infinite, Kapnin force completely disappears, and only the Mappus force is still there. And Stoll in 1996, he reproduced Kapnin results, which are very complicated. You see, you have to solve a huge equation, which has been written by, I don't remember, by you, no. Who has written these complicated equations for the non-equilibrium dynamics? But instead he just considered the transport transport just along this branch, and he exactly reproduced the results by. By Kapnin. So Stone was actually the last step in all this business, because using this Karl anomaly and suppression of Karl anomaly due to these jumps, he completely reproduced the equations as a function of temperature and as a function of temperature. Okay. This reproduce both results Kapnin and Mappus-Stoll. So this I already told about, that there is an extra force which acts on the Euler equations, and 1 minus alpha prime divided by alpha corresponds to the Kapnin number, which is omega naught torr. And when omega naught torr is large, then Mappus force is empty, and we have turbulence. But if omega naught torr is small, and Kapnin force completely start to completely compensate the Mappus force, then one obtains that the turbulence is suppressed, and transition from turbulent state to laminar state occurs at Kapnin number of the order of unity, which is also experimentally found. This is a measurement in Manchester experiment of the Kapnin number. So solid line from Kapnin theory. Where the worst became, so this is experimental observation of this Kapnin force in this range of temperatures. Okay, so maybe just a few words about Kapnin mass. It's mass of the vortex. It's also counterintuitive. Because in both the liquids, say superfluid helium 4, the dynamics of sound is like in relativistic theory, where instead of the speed of light, there is the speed of sound. In particular, the vortex mass is equal to the vortex energy divided by c squared. So this is the Einstein relation, but applied, of course, to the relativistic dynamics of both liquid. We know that the energy of the vortex is logarithmic equivalent divergence. That's why we have the following equation for the vortex mass, which is the density times radius of the core square times the logarithm of r divided by xi. A is an interval distance, actually. And coherence is it depends on temperature, but zero temperature is also in territorial distance. So one obtains this result. And now let's go to superconductor, all to helium 3b, which have actually similar properties, but in superconductors there are many impurities and so on, which get pinning and so on, that's why it's difficult to merge the Kapnin force. But the helium 3b is a very good sample for the measurement. So what Kolya found that the vortex mass is not is determined not by the interatomic space, but is determined by the coherence lattice. So you see, interatomic space, so it's not determined by the speed of sound. Coherence lattice in superconductor is much bigger than the interatomic disk. So this is at least five order of magnitude. His coupling mass is five order of magnitude larger than it was expected from just from what people expected. So if you read the paper by Leavitt, then he expected something like that, but instead it's an absolutely different situation. So what is the origin of the coupling mass? It also comes from the again from the experiment on helium 3, where he also calculated his coupling mass. And he found that in case of the skirmion, the core radius is much bigger than the coherence length, the mass of the skirmion is not that one, but it is rho times xi times core radius. So it's again different from any expectation. So what is the origin? The origin actually come from our old paper with Volodya Mineev, where we found that there is a finite density of states in case of detection detection, and the detection plays a role of the magnetic field, and the density of state, and actually the density of the normal component is proportional to this effective magnetic field, and effective magnetic field is called L. So it depends on the radius of the skirmion. So it is xi divided by the radius of the skirmion. And that's why the mass of the vortex is rho n times the core radius squared, which gives you so what is yes, rho n times rho core radius square, and rho n is 1 divided xi divided by rho, and then we have the coupling mass. So coupling mass comes just from the excitation living inside the vortex, and this is the origin of his big mass. Okay, so I think I will stop on that. I will give more time to Volodya Mineev, who will talk about the mass experiments.
Okay, let's move to speaker. No question. Погода.
By definition, this vortex mass is a coefficient at acceleration of vortex.
Yes.
Yes. This case is our then serious science. You can estimate like you need. Because either you have a psi, either you have an effective psi which is in core, which is in parameter. Without the loss of sound.
Yes, but what is the result? So where it comes, what is the reason for psi?
Because the vortex heal only part of density in cylinder of the radius side.
So you associate your mass with energy?
No, as this coefficient of acceleration.
Then we will have r squared. For the continuous vortex, not R.
No, for continuous not, for singular adjust.
Okay, why not?
Okay.
So this coupling mass, you replace coupling force 1 over tau by 1 over tau plus I omega and get frequency dependence, and that's
frequency,
how you get
yes, frequency dependence, yeah. So it's the second. Which is proportional to omega squared.
But then it's almost always not important in this much fall postal frequency is much smaller than coupling force.
Well, sometimes it's important, sometimes not. In most cases, it's not important.
And where is it important?
It's important when the coupling just a moment, in what region when synchronous coupling force disappears or is opposite direction, when it cancels the buffer force. This.
Well, but then there is viscous force, which
viscous force, okay. No, but as far as I remember, there are region, I don't remember now what which one.
Okay, so.
I have some question in addition to this one. In principle, of course, the vortex mobility coefficient is an expansion in frequencies.
Yes. Right.
And so viscosity is one coefficient, masses next, and there are also other coefficients.
Yes.
How large they are? Because if their quantities are large, then it's not clear if you should take account of the mass term neglecting others. Because they may be imposed.
Yes, yes.
For the frequency, when you should take into account the mass term, you should take into account others.
All others, yes.
Yeah. Is that true or not?
No, this is true, but there are regions of parameter where the mass can be larger than all this.
The next, yeah.
Okay, so let us.
You cannot mention coupling force in GD4.
No, here for it is okay. It is that one.
Coupling force.
Ah, coupling force. Here for doesn't exist. Sorry, coupling force is only in Fermi liquids, not in boson, because it is related to the structure of the spectrum in Fermi liquids. There is no coupling force. It's only Yardansky force.
Generalized coupling force. Yardansky coupling force.
Yes. So these guys, they exist in boson, and this is plus in Fermi.
Okay. So let us change the speaker again.